They're good to go.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, this is Dr. Nick Delgado, and we're broadcasting to you with Dr. Joshua Helman, who is on the East Coast. I'm on the West Coast. He is a medical doctor, Harvard trained. He has got many accolades, but the most important is that he looks beyond. He did a talk recently. What is beyond the plant-based whole foods diet? And I love the subject, and we want to kind of circle back around because we started a little early on the Zoom recording. But because YouTube just joined us, and we're going to have Instagram and TikTok a little later when I get in the studio, I'm in the field right now in Newport Beach with one of my colleagues, Dr. Michael Grossman, who also treats ED, erectile dysfunction, and other intimate dysfunctional issues, and also offers a series of relationship classes. I just wanted to mention that. Well, Dr. Joshua Helman, it was leading me up to my next question. I wanted to do the checkout box. We agreed that the arteries to the male organ, the penile artery, is extremely small. And it's kind of like what you said with the canary in the coal mine, that it's the first alert far before you get chest pain, angina, cardiovascular disease, a stroke, a TIA, which I suffered when I was only 21 years old, a TIA, and I had high blood pressure as a youngster from age 15 to 21. And so I'm pretty familiar with this challenge. And I mentioned one of our colleagues, I won't use his name, but he's a very famous doctor, and he was asking for the protocol for angina. What do you do to reverse angina? What I mentioned before we went live here on YouTube was that the protocol to reverse angina is very similar to the protocol to reverse cardiovascular disease that Caldwell Esselstyn talked about in his book, Reversing Heart Disease, and is very similar to reversing ED, which I don't even think there's a book out there about reversing ED. Is there, Dr. Helman, that you know of?
A book to reverse erectile dysfunction?
Correct.
Yeah, no, I mean, it's obviously mentioned in many different books. I mean, I know Dr. Joel Kahn has a book where he talks about sexual health, but it's not specifically about erectile dysfunction.
Well, you know what? It's such a problem that guys don't want to talk about. Why don't you and I co-author a book? I'm going to commit you to. We're going to do this book about nitric oxide, cardiovascular disease, the diet, the exercise, the sleep, the hormones, peptides. Are you in on that, Dr. Nick?
I'm in, Dr. Nick. I think that's an amazing idea. We're going to make it happen.
It just dawned on me. I'm thinking, why not? I mean, gosh, every guy would love to know, or more importantly, the lady that's with the guy that's suffering, because as you know, there seems to be a 10-year lag period. So, for example, if a man is 50 years old, he has a 40% chance of having ED, erectile dysfunction, even if he takes Viagra and Cialis. Is that true?
That's true, and that's also why it's exciting to talk about nitric oxide, because nitric oxide is upstream of the Viagra and Cialis, if we look at the biochemical pathway. But I'm all for, you know, just changing lifestyle, change the foods that you're eating, in, you know, instead of, you know, hoping that a pill is going to magically open up blood flow, when just change your lifestyle.
Yeah. So let's lay the building blocks of change the lifestyle, lean into all we know about nutrient support, understand the mechanism of nitric oxide and the true success of Viagra and Cialis, which was not building up nitric oxide. You and I know there's a mechanism that's far beyond that plays into this ED equation that we'll have to address maybe in some detail in the scientific section of our new proposed book. We'll come up with a cool title. But just like I have Stop Aging Now, my new book coming out that you've endorsed, I'll send you the final version, because you know me, I kept right up to the last go to publish, updating things, correcting, adding things. And so what about Stop ED Now, besides Stop Aging Now as a series? What do you think?
I like it, except for, you know, with my background in 20 years of emergency room, emergency departments, you know, we're not telling people to stop going to the emergency room if they need it. But yeah, some people don't know what ED is. but maybe.
Okay, well, why don't we spell it out? Stop ED-erectile dysfunction now, right?
Perfect, I do like that, yes.
Okay, well, we've already got the title. We're partway there.
All right.
So tell me first, Dr. Joshua Helman, what are the lifestyle measures that everyone, man and woman, because women have orgasmic difficulties when there's reduced blood flow to the female organs, but please outline in whatever particular order you feel comfortable with, and then I'll interject a few questions as we go. Go ahead.
Sure. So we both kind of touched on a little bit. One of the first things you want to do is start eating lots of plants, because leafy vegetables, beets, vegetables have lots of nitrates that the body can make into nitric oxide, and then that nitric oxide can open up blood vessels. In addition, if you're focusing mainly on eating plants, you're not normally going to be eating high inflammatory foods that will cause, among other things, hardening of the arteries. So I would say the first subset, first pillar, is going to be your diet. And within that, you don't want to eat a lot of processed fast foods. You don't want to eat a lot of foods with added salt, oil, and sugar, because all three of those things have been shown to damage blood vessels, including the blood vessels of your, what's a good euphemism?
Why don't we say your manhood?
Manhood, okay.
Yeah, well, you know, manhood describes it, because most guys equate their sexuality, the ability to function, with their, whether they're a man or not. You know what I mean? To an extent, would you agree?
I do, yeah.
Wow. And I think women don't fully appreciate the emotional challenge for men as they age, particularly since I'm approaching my seventh decade. And yet I'm single, I'm active, I date, and, you know, I feel that pressure, you know, when I'm with a woman, and it's that time to engage in intimacy. But I follow a different realm of lovemaking. You know, I wrote a book, and by the way, I have a book by Dr. Grossman, because I'm in his office, Ageless Love, The Science, The Sexy Science of Falling in Love Forever. So kind of cool, and as you know, I wrote a book myself on mastery, love, sex, intimacy. But what I discovered was, as I age, things get more challenging. If I was just on a plant-based diet, which I've gone, shall I say, now going on my sixth month, having had testosterone pellets, full disclosure, 6 months ago, that's a long stretch if you're familiar with pellets and kind of the half-life of how long a little pellet. So they're pretty much completely dissolved in my body. So I'm now working off herbs, supplements, lifestyle, getting quality sleep, somehow trying to avoid stress, but it finds me. I don't get that situation, right? And if I don't have all those other things in place, I don't quite, I'll just be as less direct and blunt as possible, but my manhood doesn't quite stand to attention as well as it should.
That makes perfect sense. And obviously it's not just your manhood, it's being able to function in other areas of your life too. But we're just talking about your manhood right this second.
Right, but you're right. The cognition, the brain function, the drive, the enthusiasm for life, right? It all ties into our hormones.
100%, and a lot of it is also brain function. I mean, if you think about sex, a lot of it's happening in your brain. And if your brain isn't operating optimally, you know, the sexual department's not going to be as good either.
Correct. So that being said, I have like a checklist that I do on a daily basis, and I'm one of those guys that I won't say equate my life with my manhood, but I do equate my quality of life with my manhood. If my manhood is functioning, then I tend to feel that all things are good, because love, the feeling that we get, is the most important emotion. And the Blue Zone showed that recently when they documented, was it diet, was it exercise, did they drink, did they smoke, did they, you know, all these different factors. But the number one factor that came up consistently, whether people lived the longest or not, was having love and community in their life. Is that a true statement?
That's true. And the other thing that came up right close to it was optimism. There was an association with being optimistic about the future and having a good future. And it works both ways.
Wow, that's pretty fascinating. So I don't know about you, but I have kind of a series of things that also, because I'm a timeline therapist, hypnosis expert, there's certain things that I have to do to step back and correct my mindset to be optimistic. Otherwise, they say that the most driven, successful people are driven by their failures and fear of failure. But it's hard if your mind's constantly cycling through, oh gosh, if I don't do best, I'm gonna fail. If I don't, you know, make that meeting happen, I'm gonna fail. And that's a tough way to live, isn't it? It makes you live from a pessimistic perspective.
It is, Dr. Nick. And the other interesting thing though is some of the most successful people I've met have also had some of the most failures. So the more people that I look up to, and when you drill down, it's like, oh yeah, no one knows about this, but you know, you think that I'm famous for this, but I worked 5 or 10 years of, you know, I had this failed company and that failed venture, and then people just know me for the success. So the way I look at it is when I hit a failure, that's actually just an opportunity for me to grow and to learn and to take another path. And also to realize that, you know, the things that Dr. Nick, you know, and I are trying to do here, the things that we're trying to do are not necessarily easy, which is to share information that can transform people's lives, because unfortunately most people in our society are caught, they're addicted. They're addicted to a poor lifestyle. They're addicted to a lifestyle where they're eating the wrong food, where they're not getting enough sleep, where their stress level is through the roof, and where they are disconnected. You know, they're connected, they spend most of their time connected to an electronic device or a television screen. They're not connected with other people.
And that love and connection is that final hurdle that we really almost have to battle to keep close to our hearts, because as you stated, people would rather scroll through their phone or do some kind of media thing, and even though we're on the Zoom session now, but the truth is, if you're working hard to be near your tribe, and what I mean by your tribe, obviously, is those who embrace personal development as a broad category, because that means both mind, body, spirit that you're focusing on to being that better person, right? You as a medical doctor, you spent more than a third of your life, two-thirds of your life in college, postgraduate school, you know, continued training. And then I'm curious, how did you come about to embrace what I call the seven secrets or codes or pillars to health, you know, to help you look and feel great, because that's the topic of our show today. How did you come to that full realization that quality sleep and reducing stress and dealing with finding exercise within your realm and love and happiness and supplementation and hormones? I mean, these are the leading categories that predicts whether people will prevent or even reverse chronic degenerative diseases, maybe even a large percentage of infectious diseases as well. How did you come to that conclusion in your journey? Because you became a medical doctor. Most medical doctors, I'll be kind of fair, they're not trained in these arenas that we're talking about.
Yeah, that's very fair. And Dr. Nick, that was displayed to me just a week or two ago when I went to my 30th Harvard Medical School reunion in Boston. It's all relative, but it's amazing. Like I'm thinking that my classmates have figured this out like I did, but no, I'm considered, because I believe in doing things in addition to medication, prescription drugs, I am now alternative. Okay, I'm alternative, but in my journey, it was about a dozen years ago, I hit a wall. I was overweight, I had high blood pressure, and
you.
Yeah, me.
Really?
Yeah, me, who's got 2 degrees in biochemistry, you know, went to some great, you know, training, med schools, et cetera. And even I, it's like, I had trouble managing my own, you know, weight and blood pressure. I'm like, this is ludicrous. And that's when I started opening my eyes, and I read a bunch of studies. I eventually got board certified in lifestyle medicine, and, you know, and now I know the literature and all this stuff. And, but it's until your eyes are opened, you know, most of my classmates, unfortunately, have kind of just done a narrow path, and they haven't been looking, I think, like I did just very broad, you know, I'm a sponge. I just want, I don't care where the information is from. I just want to be exposed to as much information. And, but frankly, Dr. Nick, if there was a magic pill that would just reverse aging and reverse all these diseases, just one pill that I could take and get rid of being overweight and get rid of high blood pressure, sure, give me the pill and I'll ignore lifestyle medicine. But that's just not the way the real world works.
Well, coming from your experience and your 12-year odyssey to search for the real truth, if you will, to find out how to stop aging, let's kind of lean into this subject a little bit further, because it's those of the people who are part of our tribe and broadcast and programs, we're always looking for that extra tip. So let's start with something very straightforward, and that is, let's remove toxins from our environment. And you and I would agree, toxins can interfere with our hormonal metabolism. And the first toxin I want to refer to is estrogen. There is truly a time when a man or a woman could be exposed due to environmental exposures and even food basic choices to massive amounts of toxic estrogens. And these estrogens lead to a condition called estrogen dominance. Can you describe in your mind what estrogen dominance is, and how does it manifest itself, and what kind of symptoms could a person have if they have this estrogen dominance? Could it lead to obesity, certain cancers? Could it cause problems related to inability to get full, firm manhood, as we started out with, because that could compete with testosterone? Any of those things potentially a problem?
Yes, yeah, Dr. Nick, so let's just go back a second here, and we're talking about toxins. And to my mind, toxins, we're specifically going to talk about estrogen blockers, or you know, the toxins out there like the PCBs and the atrazine. But
yes.
I think it's important for people to understand that we're not just talking about one or two toxins. We're literally talking about hundreds or thousands of different chemicals that we're all exposed to, whether it's in our clothes, you know, off-gassing, in our houses, or you know, that you breathe in the air outside, the water, and the reason these toxins are disturbing to my mind is that they cause premature aging.
Yes.
So basically, pollution is associated with premature aging. If you're unfortunate enough to live right next to a freeway and breathing in all the toxins from the exhaust of the petroleum products of cars driving by, your life expectancy is lower, you know, whether cancer gets you or something else, but it's the underlying effect here are the toxins. So to give the specific one that you wanted to start with, ones that are that ruin your estrogen system, what I call them obesogens. And let me give you a specific example. I saw today a patient, a 7-year-old, who has thinking problems, has trouble calming down, you know, more than a 7-year-old. You know, obviously most 7-year-olds are hyper, but it turns out that this 7-year-old has very high levels of an estrogen compound called atrazine. And I was talking with the parents, how in the world, they live in a rural area in Michigan. And I said, that's what it is. This atrazine is being used as a pesticide. And in the fields near them, somehow it's getting into the water supply, the air supply, or even just in the food. So this is not a theoretical concept. I mean, if we're drinking water out of a plastic bottle, and I recommend you don't do that, sometimes there are estrogen-like compounds in the plasticizers, in the plastic. So not only are you getting the water, you're getting a dose of estrogen. And the things that I often see with patients who are getting too much estrogen is they're getting too much weight gain, their thinking isn't clear, and it's definitely disturbing. Dr. Nick, we could talk all night about this is crazy.
It is, and unfortunately, we're probably, when we seem to be making progress from a society and environmental control issues, and we get setbacks because with technology, they come up with new manufacturing plants, new chemicals, dumping into the ocean, let alone radiation that's going still from Fukushima off the coast of Japan on the west coast here. And no one talks about it. No one has a solution for it. And we're seeing a shocking number of cancers that are coming up, just like happened in Russia, Chernobyl. We're now starting to see them, not just the West Coast, but it's spreading to wherever these particles that end up in your air supply, in your food supply, in your water supply. So we have to use water filters. I use advanced water filters. I use reverse osmosis. I use a kind of a hydrogen creator. There's an Echo device, there's a Kangen, there's another company out there, Living Water. They're all good. I also use an Everest Air Fresh in my house, upstairs and downstairs in my office. So I'm dropping, as an ionizer, dropping these particles that enter into our environment. And then I use a HEPA filter to filter that. And then I use a far infrared spa or relax sauna to leach out chemicals that did get through my defense system. Is that going too extreme? What do you think, along with exercise to stimulate my lymphatics to really detox my body, and then taking DIM, dimethylmethane, indole-free carbonyl, cruciferous vegetable extracts, broccoli sprouts? Am I going too far, doctor, or does this make sense?
No, Dr. Nick, it makes perfect sense, but I don't want anyone out there watching this to feel overwhelmed. It's like, well, Dr. Nick is doing 30 different things, and I'm not doing any, so I give up. You know, he's Dr. Nick's going to have a long life, and I'm not. No, well, my point is, what you should get out of this broadcast today is that to pick up one or two or three things that you can do. You know, the point is every day or every week or every month, try to do a little bit better. So, for example, on the good quality water, maybe initially you'll just get a reverse osmosis unit for your drinking water, and then maybe next month you'll get a whole house system so that when you bathe and shower, you're not breathing in all these chemicals.
Wow. That would be a huge step. And then what do you suggest about the air? Did I cover it well, or anything you want to add to the air quality, short of living near the ocean in Fiji, right?
Yeah, no, I'll put a plug in for, I'm a board member of a Canadian startup called Atmophizer, which uses sound waves to basically take these very small particles that are in the air at home, and certainly in these wildfires, to take these really small particles that are, they're smaller than the width of a human hair. And what this machine does is it takes sound waves and makes these teeny tiny particles bigger. It's called a snowball effect. So it converts many small, very small particles into fewer bigger particles. And then the bigger particles can get zapped and removed. So I wouldn't change anything else that you're doing, but I would look at this new technology called agglomeration, and the company, if you're interested, is called Atmophizer or Atmophizer.com.
What would be my investment? I'm curious. I'm always into the technology. What would my investment to get such a device?
Yeah, so the current device, I believe, is on sale now for $400. So it's not, you know, it's less expensive than some of these super expensive HEPA filters. What I like about the Atmophizer is it doesn't have a filter that you need to change every month or every year. Because all it is sound waves and UV light, there's nothing to service or change.
Got it. So that being said, that's pretty impressive, because my Everest Air Fresh doesn't need anything replaced either. So that being said, what if I were to say that we could zap your intestines with something called fiber? Does fiber help with detoxification?
100%, and that's why I strongly recommend people eat whole foods, whole plants, which means, you know, fruit, vegetables, and whole grains. So it means eat an orange, don't drink orange juice, because orange juice doesn't have any fiber, And if you say, oh, but I get the orange juice with the fiber in it. No, there's very little fiber in that. You want to maximize the amount of fiber, because guess what? The fiber is a fuel for a healthy microbiome in your gut.
And there's been a lot published about the gut and the microbiome. What is this mysterious X factor that we literally live in a sea of microbes that somehow makes us healthier? What is that all about?
Well, the first thing I want to say about the microbiome is they had some lectures for us at Harvard, and they had a microbial expert who's basically saying the microbiome research only goes back 10 years. This is a relatively new field. So when you have anyone, even Dr. Nick and myself, making claims like we know everything about the microbiome and you should just buy this one supplement and that'll fix all your problems, don't believe it, because we're learning new things every day. There are certain organisms that are helpful in certain situations and not in others. So that I wanted to start with the proviso that this is a relatively new field. So, but it's true. We're all, even though we can't see it, but under a microscope, we're covered. Our skin has staph and strep growing on. I mean, we're not living in a sterile environment. And the thing is, even within our gut, there are more organisms in our gut than cells in our body. So. We need
those organisms to survive.
To survive, to make vitamins, to do all these things, to make postbiotics. We need the organisms. But the thing is, we want the good ones, not the bad ones. And unfortunately, there's no, you can't say, well, the good ones are green and the bad ones are red. It doesn't work that way. I wish it did.
So that being said, Dr. Dennis Burkett years ago talked about striving to get whole foods, which are rich in fiber, and then what some of the newer fiber doctors are talking about, biodiversity, getting a big variety to select from the various foods to get sufficient fiber. Because it's not just the bulk it creates from the fluids from the surrounding tissues, but it seems, and apparently now we're starting to recognize, that various fibers trigger various microbe flora, and it's that diversity that improves our immune system, our health, and helps to combat chemical toxins as well. Is there some truth to that?
Oh, 100%. If you go back to the research Dr. Burkett did in Africa, he was studying populations where they would eat over 100 grams of fiber a day. Whereas the typical American eats between 15 and 30 grams of fiber a day. Which, sure, it may be the U.S. RDA recommended, but I'm strongly recommending to all my patients to try to get to that 100 grams of fiber a day.
Yes, and I'm right there with you. And also, there's probably a world of benefit to probiotics, kimchi, sauerkraut, miso. I mean, all these things contribute these friendly bacteria, because you want to kind of populate the body with these very special organisms to then spawn and create populations. I even use a probiotic called Happy Gut. It's one of my favorite. I use it every day, and it's just rich in all these different strains, like billions of strains, right? And we have clinical proof that these little friendly bacteria get into the system and populate the body in a healthy fashion, whereas those people who are using antibiotics, they're trying to wash everything to completely sterile. They're using all these techniques, and yet it may take them a year or two to repopulate their gut and enhance or restore their immune system, which affects their brain function as well.
Yeah, I think that's true. And the other thing that may gross people out, but from my understanding of the research, You don't just have a microbiome in your gut or your mouth or your skin. You also have a microbiome of your brain and your bladder.
Wow.
Yeah. So even though, like, we were taught in medical school, 30, 35 years ago, hey, normally you don't have bugs in your brain, you don't have you shouldn't have bugs in your bladder. That's just not true. So there, again, this is a brand new field. Get ready for some craziness. And I think the research is going to be developing exponentially, you know, in this field.
So let's come back full circle. We talked about lifestyle measures to live a longer, better quality life, the seven secrets to look and feel great. And I think we did a good job of covering removal of toxins and chemicals, and then the microbiome and fiber and its connection to health and well-being and longevity. But I don't know a guy who's listening to the show. We started off the show talking about ED, and an expert just walked in the room, Dr. Michael Grossman, who wrote the book Ageless Love and Love Forever. But the point that I'm talking about now is that if a man's hormone levels drop and a woman's hormone levels drop, let's particularly lean into, say, testosterone. Just because the lab values for men each decade of age, we mentioned that ED or erectile dysfunction increases in a man 50, 60, 70, a 7-year-old has a 60% chance of suffering from ED, even using things like Viagra and Cialis. So how can we nutrify with nitric oxide? How can we bring the testosterone levels up to where they need to be? And how can we function as we age, since this next year after this, I'll be 70? What do I need to do to be that super stud that, like, doesn't walk in on a date with a girl and go, hey, honey, I'm just going to have to take a nap because I just can't get there?
Yeah, no, Dr. Nick, I think you figured it out, but let's share that with everyone else. You know, so,
well, I mean, through trial and error and knowing different protocols.
I mean, and I think the other scary thing on this that some people there don't know is that if you look at the testosterone levels of men in this country, it's fallen, and sperm counts have also fallen. So, and I think the reason for that are these environmental toxins. We talked about estrogen-like compounds that are, they're almost everywhere. They're in the food supply, they're in the air and the water. So what can you do to reverse it? I mean, one of the things, Dr. Nick, is you mentioned testosterone pellets. You know, if you try everything else and you can't get adequate testosterone levels, I'm not opposed to using bioidentical hormones like testosterone.
Okay. That being said, you're an expert in nitric oxide. Give us a few tips.
Sure. So nitric oxide is one of those compounds that will help us improve our blood flow, because nitric oxide is just that. It's one nitrogen and one oxygen level atom stuck together. So it's NO. And it's a basic molecule that's used by the body to open up blood vessels. And if you think about it, after you take a nitric oxide supplement, the one I take is called CardioMiracle. After you take it, or if you don't want to take a supplement, you know, after you chew some leafy greens and then the bacteria in your mouth make nitric oxide, what happens is your blood vessels get bigger, including the blood vessels that go to your brain, to your heart, to your lungs, to your muscles. And I like taking a nitric oxide supplement right before working out. I find I get a much better workout. But nitric oxide isn't just used to improve the size of blood vessels. It's also used, it's basically used in every organ, every tissue of your body. As an example, it's used by your immune system. Nitric oxide, NO, will combine with an oxygen molecule, O2, to form a molecule called ONO, O-M-O-O, which is used by the white blood cells, the neutrophils in your immune system to kill other bugs. So I think about nitric oxide just like I think about oxygen. It's a building block of life that we've been designed to use it. And that's why I'm a big fan of nitric oxide supplements and chewing leafy greens. So here's some other tips. There are two places in the body that nitric oxide is produced. One is in the mouth and one is in the gut. That's the reason why when you have leafy greens, you want to chew them, because you want to maximize the production of nitric oxide in your mouth. Another good tip is that the bacteria in your mouth and your tongue that produce the nitric oxide, their number will go up if you use tongue scrapers. That's what the studies have shown. So if you regularly scrape your tongue, you somehow select for good microbiome in your mouth and on your tongue that will produce more and more of this nitric oxide. So nitric oxide will help lower your blood pressure, but it will also open up blood vessels. The other interesting thing is it will also turn back your biologic clock, your biologic age, and it's interesting to note that your nitric oxide level goes down as you grow older. So, you know, you may, at the age of 20, you might have 100% level. For the average American, by the time you're, you know, 60 or 70 years old, you may be down to 30% of your nitric oxide level. But the whole point is we want to get that level back up to improve the health of your blood vessels, specifically the endothelium, which is the single cell lining of all of your blood vessels. So,
yeah, so that being said, and thank you for that discourse on nitric oxide, because, you know, you and I know that that lead pencil, the manhood, if you don't have enough nitric oxide, you can't fill it up. And if you can't fill it up, that blood flow is necessary for the engorgement, if you will, for the satisfaction of both the man and the woman. And if you're constantly battling with that, I mean, I use Stay Young chewable tablets, chew them up, and it releases a lot of nitric oxide because they have a plant base. And I also use astragalus because it helps with TA, that, you know, type of, shall I say, longevity, fortification that the human body needs. So you and I need to inform the public that it'd be great if we could get all from plants. And by the way, I'll do like beets, and I'll blend them in a Vitamix, and then I'll mix that, you know, with my chewable tablets, because I'm not going to leave it to chance. I got to make sure I hit those benchmarks, and you can measure the presence of nitric oxide, but more importantly, you can measure the outcome. Either the manhood stands to attention when it's appropriate and needed, or it doesn't. And if it doesn't, it's because whatever you're doing. And we do know that oils in the diet interfere with nitric oxide and endothelial lining. There's certain stress factors that affect nitric oxide. But exercise, which brings me back full circle, what role does exercise play in maintaining circulation throughout the body? And is there a nitric oxide factor associated? You mentioned, you know, that getting that nitric oxide level up not only helps get your manhood up, it helps you with your workouts and your sleep and other factors of the immune system.
Yeah, 100%. So there's a lot of great information there, Dr. Nick. So I would say first of all, one thing that you want to avoid if you want to keep your nitric oxide levels up is you want to avoid caffeine. Because caffeine will prevent the production of nitric oxide. So that's an important reason to stay away from caffeine.
Wow. I'm so glad you brought that up, because honestly, you and I are keeping up with the literature as much as possible. And I've often personally decided not to use caffeine, you know, in my regime, and some of my recommended. But that's the first strong statement that I've heard tied into specifically the mechanism of caffeine and its interference with nitric oxide.
100%. Yeah. So, but if you're watching this now and you're basically addicted to caffeine, don't try to cold turkey it.
Do it.
Find substitutes. Use herbal teas, other things.
Yeah, so, yeah. I have a product called I Have Energy, and it has like a green tea. It's a little gentler. So I agree with you. That transition's important.
Cool. So you're asking about exercise. I mean, we can talk a whole hour about exercise. I mean, the amazing thing about exercise is that it hormonally changes. It improves the production of nitric oxide, but it also improves the peptides like BDNF, brain-derived neurotrophic factor, which improves thinking. And exercise is, to me, exercise is like a supercharged, you know, more stronger than any medication that you could ever take. You know, from how it basically improves almost every organ in the body. It improves the amount of mitochondria that you have in each cell. And to my mind, it's the concept of hormesis. What doesn't kill you makes you stronger. So we're not designed, despite what, you know, how you might feel, we're not designed to sit, you know, on a couch all day and eat lots of food and not move. Even though, you know, we all may have inertial days of not wanting, you know, to move, but no, unfortunately, if you just sit, you know, even if you even feel the healthiest, if you don't feel like Dr. Nick and myself, where we take exercise, we take all this to heart, we try to live and be the example. But if you or I just said, you know what, I'm tired of this, I'm just going to sit on my couch and watch Netflix all day and, you know, not see any more patients. And you know what? Sure, we tell everyone to eat plants. We're just going to eat ho-hos or, you know, I don't know if they still make that stuff, but we're going to eat.
They do.
Yeah. We're going to eat all this stuff we see advertised on TV. Well, guess what? You or I or anyone else, even in really good shape, within a week or two or three or four, we're not going to be in good shape anymore. We're not designed to sit still. We're designed for exercise and all. You know, if you think about our ancestors, The ancestors who survived were not the ones who avoided exercise. It's not compatible with life. Now, the flip side is we're not designed to, you know, run 10 hours every day. No, that's not human. But the flip side is we're not designed to run or walk 0 hours a day either.
Yeah, I'm glad you bring that up. And the classic example is putting one leg in a cast and the other one's not in a cast. And that leg in a cast literally atrophies. The muscles literally just kind of get absorbed and dissolved and essentially, metabolized into energy or tissue, and the muscles just shrink down. So as we age, we're running a similar problem. It's like leaving the body, if it's immobile and you're not doing exercise, at least brings you to what I call flow training, where you're able to carry on a conversation during the exercise. But I love to take it to that next level with high intensity, my 12-minute, all eight muscle groups to complete muscular failure, because that's the quickest way I've seen to reverse muscle atrophy. And it happens within weeks, not months. It's just amazing. Sure, to a degree, some of it's muscle memory. Obviously, you know, myself, I've broken a few world records in strength and endurance. So I can get in shape pretty quickly, but I can also get out of shape pretty quickly, as you stated, by just choosing a lazy lifestyle. And it's not enough just to, you know, mow your lawn or, you know, just kind of sit at the desk and move your arms on your iPad. I mean,
or watching sporting events, watching someone else play tennis, that doesn't really do it. You know, you may have mirror neurons, but they don't work out for you. Or, I mean, you know, think about the videos of astronauts that have been in like a zero-G environment for many, you know, days or weeks or months, and then they come back to the Earth, you know, and even though they're trying to exercise in outer space, you know, all of a sudden they go from like zero gravity or microgravity to, you know, normal, you know, it's like they can't move, they can't walk. So, you know, it's not their fault, they were just in an environment where they couldn't exercise the same way.
So would we be so bold to say, and I'm glad in the open to show, I think I'm just bringing it back full circle, the most successful people on the planet have not been afraid to experiment and to try and to risk failure. I mean, failure is something we learn from, and fortunately we're these bio machines that we can kind of figure out that didn't work. I better, you know, take a new direction. And so it's once been stated that it's the wise person who learns from other people's mistakes. A smart person will learn from their own mistakes. But you and I have combed the medical literature. Michael Greger has got 12 full-time researchers that have reviewed 2,500 medical journals per month. Michael Clapper, who worked for me in Torrance and in Huntington Beach, worked as a plant-based whole foods doctor who also understood the necessity to deal with traditional medicine issues. But, you know, when you're dealing with high blood pressure, angina, heart disease, diabetes, cancer, these things don't happen just by circumstance and due to genetics. Most of this stuff is something that can be modified or changed through epigenetics and through our own lifestyle interventions, our choice of supplements, and the seven factors of health. Is that to a degree true?
Oh, it's 100% true, Dr. Nick. And yeah, I'm a big fan of Dr. Greger and Dr. Pfeffer. I think they're brilliant. Those were two of my teachers in this whole process. And I think to boil it down, people have a choice. You can stay. America and a lot of the Western world are currently, our healthcare system is in a disease model. You're not allowed to get treated for any disease until you actually have that disease. So that's the current disease model. I'm suggesting, I'm sure you agree, it would be much better if we prevent you getting any disease, if we turn back your biologic clock, because all these chronic diseases you mentioned, they're diseases of aging. So if we can turn back your biologic clock, it's a lot less likely that you're going to get cancer and heart disease and arthritis and stroke and all these other bad things. So, but our current system isn't set up that way. Our current system is not, doesn't reward you for exercising. No, they say, you know, live your life, and if you get this diagnosis of diabetes or whatever, then we'll treat you. We're not going to give you any medicine or any supplement or encourage exercise to prevent you from getting these diseases. Oh, no. We're only going to pay for this after you have your heart attack. Then, after, you know, you've proven that what we know to be true is that if you live a Western lifestyle and eat the wrong foods and have high stress and don't get enough sleep and don't have enough connection, sure, you're going to get clogged up arteries and other chronic diseases. Only then will we teach you how to meditate and reduce stress and eat the right way. I mean, it's ludicrous, but that's the system we're in. That's the inertia. And people are like, oh, well, my health insurance only pays for this. It won't pay for me to buy Dr. Nick's supplements. So, but my message to you is, you get what you pay for. I would much rather pay for good supplements right now that will prevent me from getting all these problems later. So another example is this new Galleri or Galleri test for cancer, this blood test for cancer, where you can just do a simple blood test, and within a couple weeks, 2 or 3 weeks, you'll know if you have these 50 plus types of cancers. And I can tell you for myself, I went through this test and I was happy to find out that I didn't have any of these types of cancer. Now, the truth is, I'm not aware of any single type of cancer where the results are better if you find out about the cancer months or years later. It's like, I would want to know about this information now. Now, this is an expensive test. I think it was just under $1,000, and it wasn't covered by my insurance. So a lot of people say, well, you know, I pay money for my chronic, you know, disease model healthcare, and they're not going to pay for it. So why should I, you know, put money up? You know what? I don't. If I ever get cancer, you know, to me, it's worth the pain and suffering having watched, you know, countless patients in the hospital with cancer. Sure, you can have my $1,000 all day long.
We do a live blood and a dry blood oxidology test. And full disclosure, the live blood microscopy, we're teaching a full course tomorrow that people can get certified in by yours truly, Dr. Nick. And I'd argue I've probably done more blood morphology examinations than anyone in the history of mankind, only because I go to conventions, people line up, and I get teams of microscopists to test them and then review all of these people, including the Tony Robbins event, where we tested 696 people and then monitored them for 20 years. And it's interesting that when you have that perspective, that health begins in your blood. I wrote a book, of course, that stated blood doesn't lie. And you had the opportunity to read my earlier draft of Stop Aging Now. What brought you to endorsing my book, and why is it important to kind of monitor people's preventative factors, the presence of free radical damage, oxidative stress, which I'm coming out in my next book talking about, that I opened the Pandora's box there with Blood Doesn't Lie, and you know, during the shutdown, and I was like, hey, you can't just sit back and wait for someone to give you something that you think is going to change your course of an outcome of a disease. You have to lean into the seven principles, without which any one of them can leave you falling far short of your goals to optimize your health, to look and feel great, right?
100%, yeah. So why did I endorse your book, Dr. Nick? Many reasons. Number one is, I know you personally. I know you're an ethical person. I know you walk the walk. I know this is not just, you're not just in the business to sell books. No, and that's number one. Number two, I actually read the book, and I love the detail. I hate to say it, I love the pictures too. But I love the illustrations.
There's a lot of pictures in there, more than most books.
So I like picture books. But I also love the fact that you are not afraid to focus on living tissue blood analysis. You know, even though, you know, it may be, you know, a regulatory question, you know, there's some regulatory agencies that don't like live blood analysis. I think it's amazing. And I know, you know, when I was taught in medical school is, if you want to know the health of a patient, get a sample of their blood and look at it under a microscope. I mean, microscopes are not new technology. You know, this is the basics. And, you know, I'm watching this slide up while we're talking, and I'm thinking of, you know, all the times I've picked up infections, you know, within red cells and without, just by looking at a blood specimen. And then also, I'm also thinking about the studies, and what I've seen personally is that if you look at someone's blood after they've had a high oil, high fat meal, suddenly those smooth red blood cells develop spikes, and then those spikes do damage to the linings of the blood vessels. They tear them up because you know these capillaries are very small. If you have spikes, you know, going really quickly through narrow things, they do damage. So to me, a picture is worth a thousand words, and because you have so many pictures in your book, I was like, this is a good book. Wow.
Well, that's great. So you can see your friends and your colleagues reading the book and seeing your foreword, where you made some very kind words about the importance of this book and the breakthrough that's coming out. Because, you know, I think that more and more people are a little bit fed up with what's going on in traditional healthcare, and not to bash it, but to say they need to learn from their mistakes. The mistakes are that the death rate from these chronic diseases is not on the decline. And any decline that did take place often happened, if you look historically, is through public health measures. And it's kind of like David Katz, who he's talking about diet ID and working hard to alert the public that, hey, you can take all the shots you want, but you know, at what point are you going to really embrace this as the truth to reversing disease, right?
Oh, 100%, and that's the sad thing. I mean, if you look at the outcomes in our country, you know, we're putting more and more money to win the battle on cancer and all these chronic diseases, but we're not getting the results. And for whatever reason, a lot of people don't realize this. So, I think the biggest information, the biggest concept here is that people need to take personal responsibility and manage their own health. Sure, go see a doctor when you're ill. But to my mind, you know, I look back for myself and my colleagues in medical school and other training and practice, we are trained to help people after they have a disease, especially towards the end of their life. I mean, I did most of my training in hospitals. And who goes to hospitals? Healthy people are not in hospitals. So that's why I like to make sure, tell people, you want to stay healthy and not be in a hospital, because I've seen so many times where once you're in a hospital, you get a procedure, or you get a side effect, and then things go downhill. So my point is, focus on prevention so you don't even get these diseases, so that you don't end up in a hospital. But the traditional system is not going to teach you that. And I'm all for other physicians learning about this. But to my mind, I want to bring this message to the general public, because if I'm going to wait for physicians to figure, most physicians to figure this out, it's going to be a very long time indeed.
So, Dr. Helman, how do people locate you? And I know you have some blogs and information, so what's the best way to learn more about your work? And I'm always supportive of your efforts to educate, motivate, and guide people to be their very best. We've got to stop aging, because aging, no one really dies of old age. It's been proposed recently that they die of some kind of condition, weakness, or deficiency that could have been addressed. And this doesn't mean yet that we understand how a person can live literally, you know, forever and timeless, but striving for that goal is the beginning of awareness to reach a higher plateau and stand on the shoulders of other greats like Dennis Burkitt, Nathan Pritikin, the work you cited, and others. So how do they reach you, and how can you come on our show a little bit more often and share with my audience? I mean, this is great stuff.
Yeah, so it was great to be on with you, Dr. Nick. So people can reach out to me. I think the easiest way is through my website, which is just drjosh.com, drjosh.com. And my email address is easy. It's drjosh@drjosh.com. So drjosh@drjosh.com. So in the future, I would love to come back. And, you know, I'm doing an online summit on reversing dementia in November.
Wow.
So I'm my focus is, guess what? If we can reverse aging in general, we can reverse aging in your brain. And dementia is just part of the aging process. So maybe in a few months or a couple months, I'll come back and I'll tell you about how some of the interviews are going on with reversing dementia. And I would love to be back there.
Perfect. Yeah. And I'm glad you bring that up, because mental cognition, Alzheimer's, dementia, you know, subgroups of essentially restricted blood flow to the brain, which brings us back full circle to nitric oxide, to whole plant-based eating, to keep the arteries clear in the brain, to, and not just the male manhood, as we spoke about, alluded to. But I did want to summarize, because I had my one of my friends who's on the show probably viewing in, and just open up to the last few questions to people. But that is that angina typically means there's up to 90% blockage of that coronary artery leading the heart. And oftentimes they find individuals with heart disease that they've already developed collateral circulation, new blood vessels that work around these blockages. So exercise, whole food eating, there's ways to develop with exercise new collateral circulation. In other words, we would have people exercise three times a day up to the point where they feel some chest pain, slow it down, you know, take a breath, drink water, breathe through your nose, you know, calm things down. And so learn these techniques, because exercising three times a day, you lower the triglycerides early in the morning. But some people, due to maybe not being clear about an oil-free, whole plant-based diet, that you get your essential fatty acids from nuts, seeds, avocados, almonds, they got to get out and exercise again on a treadmill or out for a walk or whatever it is that they're safe and they're monitored, because if they have cardiovascular disease and they're having chest pain, you don't push through that. And then you come back again in the evening. So now you're going to keep your blood flow, because when you lower triglycerides, which is a fancy word for fat in the blood, you burn that up through exercise. Each time, you're getting closer to maintaining that maximal circulation of the heart. You're gradually building new blood vessels. And then use cardiolipo, that is LipoBurn, a product we have with bergamot, and the berberine, which is cardioglucose. These two herbs have been shown to selectively lower LDL cholesterol, lower triglycerides, improve circulation. So here's a place with lycopene, by the way, tomato extract. All these cool things been clinically shown to work sometimes as good or better than the most number one prescribed drug in the world, which happens to be, I believe, statins, right up there with what, number one, two, or three, isn't it?
Yeah, 100%. And the general public often will not hear about these things because there's a much more financial reward for the pharmaceutical companies to market high profit pharmaceuticals than than plants that they can't patent. So it's fallen out of the legal system involving the patent system over the last 100 years, which is why we hear a lot more about pharma than we do about healing yourself with plants. And I think there's a role for both, but yeah.
Yeah, so in summary then, the final thing I want you and I to do together is to kind of wind up this class and, you know, kind of come to this place of joy and happiness and well-being and share love with the audience. I know you got an early morning start. Thanks for being our guest, and looking forward to having you on to a future show. And we know your website. We'll put that in the show notes. And any final last words for our audience?
Yeah, so I wanted to thank you for taking the first step of looking after your own health, which is watching this show. You know, Dr. Nick has an amazing track record over so many decades, and I just feel humbled to be on the same show as him. So I would also say the other thing is we all, whether it's Dr. Nick or myself, we all have times where we face challenges, and don't bring that down. Don't when you hit a wall, don't focus on that. Just focus on, okay, this approach doesn't work. There are 5 other ways I can do this. It's just one step at a time. So thanks again, Dr. Mike.
Thank you, Dr. Joshua Helman, and thanks for endorsing my new book, Stop Aging Now. It's going to be coming out early summer here, actually very close. We have the final competition judging, which is the best cover, the back. It looks like the audiences have selected the favorite, and so our initial thing is to release the ebook. And plus, I'm appearing at some events here coming up in LA on July 15th in Los Angeles at a Brentwood office where I'm doing a lecture, and we're doing microscope testing tomorrow. I'm doing the live blood and dry blood microscopy to educate people. And full disclosure, I make sure people know that, look, the microscope is not the diagnostic. It's combining it with what we know about the patient's history and doing lipid, HDL, LDL, triglycerides, cholesterol with glucose, learning their liver, kidney function, their hormones. We want to go as deep as we can, because from that we can really come up with a hypothesis and then a plan to execute for that individual to be their very best. Does that make sense?
Perfect sense, and enjoy, and you know, hopefully I'll see you the next time in California. All right, take care.
Bye-bye, everyone. Okay, we're going to all sign off. We got a pretty good audience. Wow, quite a few people. Let me just see in the chat. I'm just going to check. Thanks, Dr. Helman. I know you got to get going. Each of you, if you just kind of drop me a note if you have any questions. Here, I'm going to look in the chat. Final questions here, because we're going to sign off, because I'm here in Newport Beach with one of our doctors, Dr. Michael Grossman, who wrote the book Ageless Love, and he and I are putting together some plans that's going to make a difference. Any questions in the chat? You can unmute yourself if you wish.